I do want to take some time to talk a little bit about Docker with Ignition with you. And so we wanted to talk about this a little bit and introduce you to Docker with Ignition. This can seem a little bit daunting at first, right? Because it may be a foreign concept for a lot of you, especially those of you coming from an OT world like myself. But I'm going to introduce it to you a little bit here and hopefully provide some tips and tools that can help you get started easily, as well as maybe, you know, show you the benefits of why we like using it. So one thing I should also note is that our elective Inductive University videos on Docker and the Docker image page of our manual are great references for anybody getting started with Ignition in Docker and should be used by anyone that's starting out and trying to do that. I used them extensively when I started using Dockerized Ignition, and they are great references. I believe we're going to have those linked in the chat as well as in the slides. So first of all, though, what is it, right? Docker is a containerization engine. Well, what is containerization? It's basically virtualizing everything around an application and loading everything that's needed for an application to run within a unit called a container. These containers then basically run on a containerization engine like Docker. These containers are also not operating system dependent. They're quickly deployed and they're easily managed. So the Docker software itself, we can talk about a quick second here. Docker can be installed on mostly just about any operating system, right? But the specific version of Docker that I'm using is Docker Desktop, which is an application for Windows, which is what I'm using for my host machine, my work laptop, right? Another nice reason that I like to use it and that we're going to kind of show it off here today is because Docker Desktop includes three Docker products that are really nice, that being the underlying Docker engine. So this is the core workings of Docker. This is what runs the actual containers, right? The second being Docker Compose, which can be used to create a file that holds all of our containers configuration to be reused. We're going to see that a little bit later. It's really nice. And then the third is the Docker Desktop dashboard that you see in front of you. That's what you should be able to see on my screen now. This provides a nice little user interface with details on our containers and even more. And that's why I think it's really good for people that are just starting out. So what we're gonna do, first thing we're gonna do is we're just gonna spin up a container that is running Ignition. I'm gonna open the terminal up here within Docker Desktop and run from there. Now you could run any PowerShell, you know, or terminal that you wanted to run this in, but because we have this nice UI with an integrated terminal, let's use it. I just pasted this line in to my command line here, and you'll see that it's a Docker run command. So this is saying run the container with these parameters I'm giving you. I'm giving it this dash D flag, which tells it to run in detached mode, which just means hide all the details. I don't need to know all the intricacies of it starting up and running. The dash P flag, which is port forwarding. Now what that's gonna say is take the port that my application is running on in the container. We should all be familiar with this 8088 port that Ignition runs on. And it's gonna forward that to my host machine. That's gonna allow me to access it through that host's port. Now, one thing of note is that only one application can run on a certain host port at a time. Meaning, if you have multiple instances of Ignition running, you're not going to be able to forward them all to 8088 on the left side of this operation here, which is your host side. What I like to do there is just count up, but you need some sort of free port is the bottom line there. The next line here is the actual image that we're going to use. So this is telling it to go out, if we don't have this image already, to go to Docker Hub and grab the Inductive Automation Ignition image. And that's what it's going to use to build that specific application in our container. And then I'm giving it this latest flag. So that's just saying, hey, make it be the latest version of Ignition, whatever we have the latest version of our image created for, usually our latest released minor version. And then we have the dash N flag, which is just naming the gateway webinar at the end here. So if we run that, you'll see it gave me an output in the terminal that is a unique string. That is the ID that is unique for that container. You'll also note that the beginning part of that unique ID matches the container ID that was popped up here in this new container that showed up in my UI. You'll also see it gave me a random name, which Docker does if you don't explicitly tell it what to name the container. Usually there's something fun. If we got Serene Matsumoto, it also shows you what kind of image you were using to run it. So basically what the application is, and it even shows you what ports you forwarded. If you click on this little link as well, it'll open up that port in your web browser right to, you know, what you set up. And you'll notice that this probably looks familiar, right? This is basically the screen you go to start your configuration of your new gateway that you've just installed. There's a lot of nice information to see about the container running. There's even some little actions we can use to control the containers over here on the right. We can stop the container, which you'll see it's now in exited mode and it's not running anymore. We can even remove it. Now this completely deletes the container. It no longer exists. Everything about it is gone. We could have done both of those operations within the terminal as well, but I just wanted to showcase some of the nice features that you have when using a UI like Docker Desktop. There's also a bunch of other information on images and stuff on the left here, but I do want to jump into my next little segment here, which is Docker Compose. Now for Docker Compose, I'm going to jump into a different application called Visual Studio Code. Visual Studio Code is basically just an editor for, you know, your different files, but you'll see a couple of the reasons why I like using it specifically for my Compose files here as we go on. First thing I want to talk about though is the Compose file itself. The Compose file is a YAML file. As you can tell here, my webinar one is docker-compose.yaml. I have it open in the middle here. And basically what it does is it uses that YAML syntax with these like key value pairs to create your configuration for your container, as opposed to typing it all out in a command line. You can just basically call this file, right? So you can reuse this file, you can have a basic configuration, and that's why it's really nice. You have this set configuration. It makes it easier to add a lot of extra things too, like these environment flags where I'm automating a lot of the startup stuff that you would normally have to click through and do. One other extra thing I'm doing here that we didn't see before as well is these volumes. Now, this is also really important because what this does is it allows us to persist our configuration and resources that we develop within Ignition, because I'm mapping that Docker volume directly to the Ignition data directory. So that means if anything happens to this container, you know, it gets removed, completely deleted, it's gone, we can still respin it up, it'll remap to this volume and go back to that configuration, and we'll have not lost everything that we configured on our gateway. So a lot of nice stuff there. You can also see that I've got other applications running in my Compose container or in my Compose file, right? I've got a Postgres image that I'm spinning up a container for. This could be any other database that you want to use, you know, if it's Microsoft SQL Server or MariaDB, anything that you can get an image for, basically. Another nice thing about those Compose files is you can basically create a stack of all of the different applications you want to run integrated with each other in one file. We'll talk about the Compose file's name itself here quickly too, right? This docker-compose.yaml file name is important because the Docker Compose actually knows to run that specific file when you run it within a specific directory. You'll see if I open up these other folders, they all have their own unique docker-compose file. And that's because when I run any Docker Compose commands within those directories, they know exactly which file to run to find based on that name. So the first thing we'll kind of see here about, like I was saying, I really like VS Code for, is I can have my file explorer here, right click right on it, open in a terminal, and that terminal opens up right in this nice window where I can see my files, my terminal, and my Compose file opened all in one. You'll see that I'm in that webinar directory, and if I do a Docker Compose up, run it in detach mode again, like I mentioned, it knows exactly which file to use because of that specific name. And it'll start up these two services that we created with Ignition and Postgres. Another reason I really like VS Code for my compose files is because you can get a ton of extensions for it. You'll see I have a whole lot going on here, but we're just going to look at the Docker one today, which gives me the little Docker whale on the left. If we go to that guy, you can see that I have information on all my containers, a bunch of ones that we're not using currently are turned off, but you can see the ones that I have started up for my little webinar Docker compose file here. You'll also see we have the same ability to do like a start and a stop and remove from the extension here as we could do in that Docker desktop application. We also have similar type of information on all of our images and volumes and networks and stuff here. So I really like that Docker engine for that. And you know, if we go to a localhost 8088 on our web browser, we go right to this gateway and you'll see that it just navigated me directly to it. I didn't even need to go through and set up the, you know, username and password and all that stuff you would normally do because I automated that in all of those environmental flags in my compose file. So one last thing I'm going to leave you with here on the Docker front is that as great as it is for your development and testing, Docker is also a great and legitimate deployment method for use in production that we have plenty of customers doing. However, if you are going to license a Dockerized Ignition instance, you should be using our 8-character keys. Now, these are different from our normal 6-character keys because this is what we call a least licensing method, meaning, you know, you still just buy these licenses once, but these licenses have to reach out to our licensing server on a certain time basis, right? The main reason that this is recommended for these is because this licensing model is not tied to the specific hardware of the machine. And because of that, they're better for containerized ignition environments, as containerizing these services also decouples them from that underlying host machine's hardware in a similar fashion.